Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ms. Mohua Biswas. Today, I am going to give you a lecture on software processes. I am faculty of Swerys College of Engineering, Pandharpur. Let's start with the first slide. It's a software process. What is a software process? So before that, we should know about what is a software. A software system usually consists of a number of separate programs which are used to set up these programs, system documentation and user documentation. So normally software engineers are concerned with developing such software products, and that is why software engineering is an engineering discipline which is concerned with all aspects of software production. This software process consists of some set of activities which helps you to develop a good quality software product. So let's see what are the fundamental activities, process activities are there. So there are four fundamental process activities. First one is software specification, second one is software development, third one is software validation, and last one is software evolution. So software specification, in this case of software specification, here customers and engineers define the softwares which is going to be produced, and here the constraints of the system also defined. Second is the software development. Here the software is designed and programmed. Third is the software validation. Here the software is checked or tested in order to ensure that it is error-free. And last one is software evolution, where the software is modified in order to changing needs of the society. Next is the what is a software process model. So as the name indicate here, it is a simplified description of a software process where it consists of some activities or phases which helps to produce a good quality product. So traditionally this type of model having some phases. The first one is the requirement. Here the requirement, whatever the product requires, whatever the services we are going to, or the customer wants, services wants in this system, you have to gather it, that requirement, and design an architecture based on the requirement and implement it. Implementation means we start coding. And after coding, we have to check the test the that code or complete system if any error is there. After verification, we have to release it and release to the for the practical use, and maintenance is as well as important. So there are some types of software process model. The first one is the waterfall model, second one is the evolutionary development, and third one is the reuse oriented software engineering, or we can say it is known as component-based software engineering. Let's see one by one. What do you know about waterfall model? So the waterfall model is the first process model, which is also known as linear sequential lifecycle model. Why it is known as linear? So whatever the model you look in this slide, it is in the form of linear manner. That's why it is known as linear. And sequential, because as the name indicate here, waterfall, the waterfall, whatever the changes we have to make, you have to make within that phase only. Until unless you are not going, if you move to the next phase, it is very difficult to move to the earlier stage and correct the errors. That's why it is known as waterfall model or linear sequential lifecycle model. It is very simple to understand and use. In this case of waterfall model, each phase must be completed before the next phase can begin, and there is no overlapping in the phases. So this, in the case of waterfall model, there are some phases are there. The first phase is the requirement definition. In the case of requirement definition, we have to capture all the requirements and do the requirement feasibility test in order to ensure that the requirements are testable or not. Second one is the system and software design. So here, as per the requirement, we are going to create the design and document the designs. In the third phase, that is implementation and unit testing, as per the requirement or as per the design, we have to create the program or code and do the unit testing of that code. Each unit is developed independently here and can be tested for its functionality. That's why this type of testing is known as unit testing. Next phase is the integration and system testing. Here in this phase, we are going to integrate the unit tested code and test it to make sure if it works as expected. We have to perform all the testing activities to make sure that the system meets the requirements. And next is the operation and maintenance. In the case of operation and maintenance, as soon as the product is tested and deployed, it enters the maintenance phase of the software development lifecycle. The system is handed over to the customer and will be used by the first time by the customer. Naturally, here the customer will check if his requirements were implemented as expected, but if the correct requirements have been set up in the beginning. In case if there are changes is necessary, it has to be fixed to make the system usable or to make it comply to the customer wishes. So let's see some advantages of waterfall model. So this model is simple and easy to use and understand. In this model, phases are completed at a time, and that's why the phases do not overlap. Waterfall model works well for smaller projects where requirements are very well to understand. So let's see the disadvantages of waterfall model. In the case of your waterfall model, once an application is in the testing stage, it is very difficult to go back and change something that was not well thought out in the concept stage. Next is the no working software is produced until late during the life cycle. Third one is it gives high amount of risk and uncertainty. And it is not suitable for complex projects. So let's see the next process model, that is the evolutionary development. So this evolutionary development provides feedback to developers, which will result it can repair through many versions until an adequate system can be developed. The evolution development divides the system cycle into smaller incremental waterfall model in which users are able to access to the product at the end of each cycle. This incremental, or you can say evolution development model, works or completes having a duration of 2 or 4 weeks until the product is delivered. So this evolution development model is also known as iterative process model, and is suitable for complex problems also, complex type of software products. So under this, there are two approaches. The first one is the exploratory development. Here, the customers works along with the developer, and whatever the final system is evolved, it should start with the well-understood software. In the case of throughaway prototyping, the customer are worked along with the developer, and it should start with the poorly understood requirement, where whatever the requirement which is not understood properly, we have to work, it is worked under this type of approach. So let's see what are the advantages of evolutionary development. So under this, first one is the users get a chance to experiment with a partially developed system. Next, it helps to find the exact user requirement. It is useful for very large problems. Fourth one, it reduces the development cost. Next, it reduces the user involvement. Next is the disadvantages of evolution development. It can lead to insufficient analysis. Next is, because as the evolution development, it can cause systems to be left unfinished and incomplete documentation. Let's see the third type of model, that is the component-based software engineering. This component-based software engineering objective is to ensure the component reusability. Here we can reuse the component which is already exist. So here, in the case of component-based architecture, it divides the problem into sub-problems and each problem is associated with component partitions. A general process model for reuse-based development is shown in figure. Here, there are some stages is given. The initial requirement specification stage and the validation stage are comparable with other software processes. Whatever the intermediate stages are there, it is discussed here. So first one is the component analysis. Here, as per the given requirement specification, a search is made for component to implement that specification. If the exact match is not find out, the components that may be used only provide some of the functionality required. Next is the requirement modification. During this stage, the requirements are analyzed using information about the components that have been discovered. They are then modified in order to reflect the available components. Wherever the modifications are impossible, the component analysis may be re-entered to search for alternative solutions. Next is the system design with reuse. During this phase, the framework of the system is designed or an existing framework is reused. The designers take into account the components that are reused and organize the framework to cater for this. Next is the development and integration. The software that cannot be externally developed and the component systems are integrated to create the new system. Here the system integration in this model may be part of the development process rather than a separate activity. So let's see some advantages of CVAC. So it reduces the cost of development and maintenance. It is reusable, which means it can be used to reusable components. Next, it increases the reliability of the whole system via reuse. It is easy to maintain and update the implementation without affecting the rest of the system. Let's see the disadvantages. The disadvantage is if the suitable components is not fit the architectural design of the software, it very difficult to find out the next match. So let's see the next point, that is the software process activities. In the case of software process activities, you have already seen the definition. The software process activities is a set of required activities and the outcome of the activities which produce a quality software product. A software process is a flowchart of developing a software product which includes gathering requirements, analyzing those requirements, scheduling development phases, checking the developments, implementing changes, and many more are there. And this can be till the delivery of the final software product to the after delivery service methods and more. So under this process activities, there are following four activities are there which are common to all software process models. The first one is the software specification or requirement engineering. Next one is the software design and implementation. Third one is the software validation. And last one is the software evolution. So let's see one by one. The first one is the software specification. Under this software specification, it is also known as requirement engineering. It is the process of understanding and defining what services are required from the system and identifying the constraint on the system's operation and development. So this requirement engineering type of activity is a very critical stage of the software process until unless an error, whatever the error, if it is occur, it may lead to later problems in the system design and implementation process activity. So there are four main activities which comes under this requirement engineering process. The first one is the feasibility study. So here an estimate is made of whether the identified user needs may be satisfied using current software and hardware technologies. The study considers whether the proposed system will be cost effective from a business point of view or it can be developed within existing budgetary constraints. A feasibility study should be relatively cheap and quick. The results should inform the decision of whether or not to go ahead or with a more detailed analysis. Next is the requirement elicitation analysis. This is the process of deriving the system requirements through observation of existing systems, which is going to discuss here. Next is the requirement specification. Your requirement specification is the activity of translating the information gathered during the analysis activity into a document that defines a set of requirements. And last is the requirement validation. This activity checks the requirements for realism, consistency, and completeness. During this process, errors in the requirements document are inevitably discovered. It must then be modified to correct these problems. Next is the software design and implementation. Here, the implementation stage is the process of converting the system specification into an executable system. It always involves the process of software design and programming. A software design is a description of the structure of the software to be implemented, interfaces between system components, and sometimes algorithm used. It is an abstract model of this process, showing the inputs to the design process, process activities, and the documents produced as outputs from this process. The first phase is the architectural design. Here, in the case of architectural design, we identify the overall structure of the system, the principal components, their relationships, and how they are distributed. Next is the abstract specification. Here, in the case of abstract specification, a subsystem services and its operating constraints are produced. Next is the interface design. Here, it defines the interface between the system components. And last is the, fourth one is the component services that are allocated, and its interfaces also designed in this phase. Fifth one is the data structure design. Here, implementation is designed and specified. And sixth one is the algorithm design. Here, start for the coding. So in this algorithm design, you have translating a design into a program and removing the errors from that program. The programmers carry out some program testing to discover the faults in the program and remove these faults in the debugging process. In the case of the debugging process, if you see the debugging process below, the debugging process consists of locate errors. You are going to locate the errors, and whatever the error is generated, we have to design to repair such errors and then repair the errors and retest that program whether it is error free or not. Let's see the next process activity, that is the software validation. So here the software validation, or we can say is a verification or validation process activity, which is intended to show that a system both conforms to its specification and that it meets the expectations of the software system customer. It involves checking and review processes and system testing. System testing involves executing the system with test cases that are derived from the specification of the real data to be processed by the system. The stages in the testing processes are, the first one is the component or unit testing. So here the individual components are tested independently for correct operation. Next is the system testing. Here the testing of the system as a whole to validate the functional and non-functional requirements. Next is the acceptance testing. Here the testing with customer data in order to check that the system meets the customer needs and performance. The system here, the acceptance testing is also known as alpha testing. The alpha testing process continues until the system developer and the client agree that the delivered system is an acceptable implementation of the requirements. Here, when a system is to be marketed as a software product, a testing process called beta testing is often used. This beta testing involves delivering a system to a number of potential customers who agree to use to that system. And the last software evaluation is the last software process activity. So what it means, evaluation means changes. This software process activity is inherently flexible and can change. As the requirements change through changing business circumstances, the software that supports the business must also evolve and change. Although there has been a split between development and evolution, software maintenance cost is several times the development cost here. In the case of evolutionary process development process activity, here the software is continually changed over its lifetime in response to changing requirement and customer needs. If you see the diagram of this, so here we are going to define a system requirement first and check if there is a, as per the requirement, is there, if it go any change, existing system is present or not. If it is present, we have to make small modifications, and based on the modification, whatever the system we are going to develop is a modified system and it's a new system. But if it is not existing, we have to go for a new system. That is comes under a software evolution process. So this is all about your coping with change. Let's move to your next, that is coping with change. Here, that as we all know that change is unavoidable in all large software projects. Therefore, and it is also important for business point of view. New technologies are coming day after day. So under this coping with change, there are two main approaches. First one is the reducing the cost of rework. Under this, two more are there, that is the change avoidance. Change avoidance means what? As we all know that proverb, precaution is better than cure. That means what? Before the faults occur, we have to make the precautions. And next one is the change tolerance. It means what? If the faults occur, we have to tolerate it, or we have to find out the alternate solutions. Next is the process iteration, which comes under this coping with change. Here, under this, two types of process iteration means what? Repetition of the phases or rounds of or cycle of the operations. So under this, there are two ways are there which follows this coping with change, that is the incremental delivery and Bowen's spiral model. Let's see one by one. Incremental delivery. In the case of incremental delivery process, customers identify the services to be provided by the system. They identified which of the services are most important and which are least important to them. A number of delivery increments are then defined, which with each increment providing a subset of the system functionality. The allocation of services to increments depends on the service priority, with the highest priority services implemented and delivered first. Once the system increments have been identified, the requirements for the services to be delivered in the first increment are defined in detail, and that increment is developed. Requirements changes for the current increment are not accepted. Once an increment is completed and delivered, customers can put it into service. This means that they take early delivery of part of the system functionality. They can experiment with the system, and this helps them clarify their requirements for later system increments. As new increments are completed, they are integrated with existing increments so that the system functionality improves with each delivered increment. So let's see what are the advantages of incremental delivery. Here, the customer do not have to wait until this entire system is delivered. The first increment satisfy their most critical requirements, so they can use the software immediately. Next is the there is a lower risk of overall project failure. Next is the this model is more flexible and less costly. Here, the fifth one, it is easier to manage risk. And last, it is easier to test and debug during a smaller iteration. These advantages are, it needs good planning and design. It needs a clear and complete definition of the whole system before it can be broken down and built incrementally. And last, it costs higher than the waterfall model. So next model is the Bowen's spiral model. Why it is known as Bowen's spiral model? Because it was originally proposed by the Bowen, the name of a scientist, researcher, in the year 1988. Here, rather than represent the software process as a sequence of activities, the process is represented as a spiral. Each loop in the spiral represents a phase of the software process. Here, the innermost loop might be concerned with the system feasibility, next loop with requirement definition, next loop with the system design, and so on. So under this spiral model, each loop in this plate is split into four sectors. First one is the objective setting. Here we have to specify, here the specific objective for the phase of the project are defined. constraints on the process and the product are identified, and a detailed management plan is drawn up here. In this type of phase, the project risks are identified, and an alternative strategies depending on these risks may be planned. Next is the risk assessment and reduction. For each of the identified project risks, a detailed analysis is carried out and steps are taken to reduce the risk. Next is the development and validation. After risk evaluation, a development model for the system is chosen. And next is the planning. The project is reviewed and a decision is made whether to continue with a further loop of the spiral or not. If it is decided to continue, plans are drawn up for the next phase of the project. So let's see what are the advantages of spiral model. It produces high amount of risk analysis. Next is the is a good for large and mission critical projects. Next, third one is the software is produced early in the software lifecycle. So let's see the disadvantages of spiral model. It can be costly model. It does not work well for smaller projects. For third one, for its smooth operation, spiral model protocol needs to be followed strictly. Fourth, it is not suitable for low risk projects, and it may be difficult to define objective. Next is the point is the rational unified process, or in short, in abbreviated form, we can say it's a RUP. This RUP is a software development process, which is a division of IBM. This rational unified process is a guide for how to effectively use the unified modeling language. This language is known as UML shortly. This UML is an industry standard language that allows us to clearly communicate requirements, architectures, and designs. The UML was originally created by Rational Software and is now maintained by the standard organization that is known as Object Management Group. So it is known as OMG, that is in abbreviated form. This rational unified process is a software engineering process. It provides a disciplined approach to assigning tasks and responsibilities within a development organization. Its goal is to ensure the production of high quality software that meets the needs of its end users within a predictable schedule and budget. The rational unified process is a process product developed and maintained by Rational Software. The development team for the Rational Unified Process are working closely with customers, partners, Rational's product groups, as well as Rational's consultant organization, in order to ensure that the process is continuously updated and improved upon to reflect the recent experiences and evolving and proven best practices. So under this, there are four phases are there. The first one is the, let's see one by one, inception. The goal of the inception phase is to establish a business case for the system. It is going to identify all the external activities that will interact with the system and define these interactions. We then use this information to assess the contribution that the system makes to the business. If this contribution is minor, then the project may be cancelled after this phase. Next is the elaboration phase. The goal of the elaboration phase are to develop an understanding of the problem domain, establish an architectural framework for the system, and develop the project plan and identify key project risk. Next is the construction. In the case of construction phase, it involves system design, programming, and testing. Parts of the system are developed in parallel and integrated during this phase. On completion of this phase, you should have a working software system and associated documentation that is ready for delivery to users. And last is the transition. In the final phase of the RUP, it is concerned with moving the system from the development community to the user community and making it work in a real environment. So let's see the last, not the least, is the attributes of good software. So software products have a number of other associated attributes that reflect the quality of that software. These attributes are not directly concerned with that software, what the software does. Rather than they reflect its behavior while it is executing and the structure and organization of the source program and associated documentation. So there are some essential attributes are there for a good software. So first one is the maintainability. It means the software must evolve to meet the changing needs of the customer. Next is the dependability. Here the software must be trustworthy, means it should produce reliable, software should be reliable, secure and safe. Next is the efficiency. It means software should not make wasteful use of software resources such as memory. And last one is the usability. Here the software must be usable by the users for which it was designed. So there are some key challenges are there. The key challenges means what the software engineering are some facing some challenges. And first one is delivery challenge. Delivery means what? Challenge means if your product is not timely produced or developed, it is very difficult to deliver it within a time period. And next one is the trust challenge. In the case of trust challenge, if it is not trustworthy, if your product, whatever the product you have developed, if it is not developed it is not secure, it is not trustworthy, the product is not giving us error free data, then it is very difficult for the users to depend on that software. So that is all about the software processes. So last, you have just completed by saying that processes should include activities to cope up with change. This may involve a prototyping phase that helps avoid poor decisions on requirements and decision. That's why the processes may be structured for iterative development and delivery so that changes may be made without disrupting the system as a whole. So I hope you will enjoy the video. Thank you so much. Hello everyone. So earlier we have seen about the software processes. Now we move to the next part, that is the system models. So first of all, we'll come to know about what is system modeling. System modeling is a process of developing abstract models of a system, with each model presenting a different view or perspective of the system. Normally, system modeling helps the analyst to understand the functionality of the system, and models are used to communicate with customers. The most important aspect of a system model is that it leaves out some details. System modeling is a representation of a system that should maintain all the information about the entity which is being represented. So there are different models to represent the system from different perspectives. For example, an external perspective point of view, where the model are context or environment of the system. If we see the interaction perspective, the model defines the interaction between a system and its environment, or between the components of a system. In structural point of view, the model is the organization of a system or the structure of the data that is processed by the system. And in behavior perspective, the model is the dynamic behavior of the system, and it also explains how it responds to the different events. Next, we move to the software development life cycle. Shortly, or you can say in abbreviated form, software development life cycle, having the abbreviated form is SDLC. It is a process that describes how to develop, design and maintain the software project, ensuring that all the functional and user requirement goals and objectives are met. This methodology improves the quality of the software project and overall process of software development. The product life cycle has four very clearly defined stages, each with its own characteristics. That means it is having different things for business that are trying to manage the life cycle of their particular products. So first phase is introduction. In the introduction phase, it is the period where a new product is first introduced into the market, where the company may set prices higher because of new technology. In the growth phase stage, the sales and profits for the new product start rising. A company will usually keep product prices about the same during the growth stage to minimize the earnings. Product quality is also maintained in this stage. However, a company will usually expand its product distribution during the growth stage. In the case of maturity stage, it is when the demand for the product and its competitors will peak at some point. Other companies eventually will start introducing similar products. Also, sales growth will start to decline in this stage. And in the last stage, that is the decline stage, the decline stage is when the companies can either maintain the product, sell it at heavily reduced prices, or discontinue the product. In this stage, both sales and profit declines. So let's see one by one different models, system models. The first model here, it is a context model. So this context model is a model which is used to give an overview of an entire system. In a context model, there is only one circle that represents the entire system. The purpose of the model is to display the expecting inputs and outputs from the system to and from various external entities. Through this, a system analyst can model what expected data is going to go into the system, then after it has been processed by the system, what information will be returning to the external entities. In the diagram, there is one external entity that will enter data into the system, where there is only one circle oblique process in the model, and the flow line represents what data is going into the system, and there is one more flow line usually returning to the external entity of the process information. Let's see some notations. What are the notations used in context diagram? A square represents an external data source or data destination. A oval indicates a internal entity or transformation process. A line with an arrow indicates the direction of the flow of data. Let's take an example of context model of an ATM system. In the above context of an ATM system, auto teller machine is connected to an account database, a local branch accounting system, a security system, and a system to support machine maintenance. The system is also connected to a usage database, which monitors how the network of ATM is used, and to a local branch counter system. This counter system provides services such as backup and printing. Let's see some advantages of context model. It shows the scope and boundaries of a system, including the other systems that interface with it. Second one, no technical knowledge is required to understand the model. Third, it is easy to draw. Next is Disadvantages of context model. Here, memory requirement of the model frequently exceeds the size of the file which is being compressed. Next model is interaction model. The interaction models shows the interaction between the components of a system or between the system which is being developed and other systems. Modeling user interaction is important as it helps to identify user requirements. The purpose of interaction diagram is to visualize the interactive behavior of the system. So there are two related approaches to interaction modeling. Number one is the use case modeling, which is mostly used to model interaction between a system and the external actors. And second one is the sequence diagram, which is used to model the interactions between the actors and the objects within a system. Let's see each model one by one. The first one is the use case modeling. A use case can be taken as a simple scenario that describes what a user expects from a system. It does not show the detail of the use cases. It only summarizes some of the relationships between the use cases, actors, and systems. This use case model was first formulated by Ivor Jacobson in the year 1986, and after that one book was published in the name Object Oriented Software Engineering, a Use Case Driven Architecture in the year 1992, which helped to popularize this technique. So let's see some use case diagram notations. This use case diagram notations consists of normally four notations are there. First one is the actor. So this actor represents the end user, system or device. It is usually drawn like a skeleton. Next is the use case notation. A use case represents a function or system function. Each actor must link to a use case. It is drawn as an oval shape. Third notation is boundary of the system. The system boundary is the entire system. It is used to define the scope of the use case and it is look like a rectangular shape. Next is the communication link. The participation of an actor in a use case is shown by connecting an actor to a use case by a solid line. Actors must be connected to use case, indicating that the actor and the use case communicate with one another using messages. Let's see an example of use case of medical health center. That is, the system name is patient monitoring system, where your patient medical receptionist acts as an actor and register patient, unregister patient, view patient information, transfer data, contact patient. These things which is under the oval shape indicates the use cases. So this medical receptionist can register the patient information, can unregister the patient information, can register the patient. It can also record the patient information. It can transfer the data of patient information to the doctor system, and it can also contact the patient info, a patient, whoever it is going to contact. So this is a simplified structure of a use case of a patient monitoring system. Next is sequence diagram. Next approach comes under interaction model is sequence diagram. A sequence diagram is the most commonly used interaction diagram. The sequence diagram simply illustrates how the different parts of the system interact with each other, which carry out a function sequentially. The sequence diagram is also known as event diagram. These diagrams are widely used by software developers to document and understand the requirements for new and existing systems. Let's see the notation which comes under the sequence diagram. The first is the actor. An actor, already I have discussed with you, an actor represents a type of a role where it interacts with the system and its object. Next notation is known as lifeline. A lifeline depicts an individual participant in a sequence diagram. Lifeline elements are located at the top in a sequence diagram. And third is the messages, where communication between objects is depicted using messages. The messages appear in a sequential order on the lifeline. We represent messages using arrows. Let's take an example of sequence diagram for update the patient monitoring system. The sequence diagram that describes the interaction involved in the view and update the patient information. If we'll see the diagram of the sequence diagram of patient monitoring system, here the receptionist can first log in to the system. For that, it is first update the task for update the information. Ask for update the information of the patient. It is moved to the database, and from that it is going to ask for authorization, and then get the authorization, it is going to update the patient authorization or patient information, and after completion of the task it is then go for execution, and then or you can at the end it is go for comes out from the main thing, that is exist from the main system. So this is a complete overview of a patient monitoring system. Next model is a behavior model. As the name indicate here, it describes the overall behavior of the system. It also describes the dynamic behavior of the system as it is executing. So there are two types of behavioral model which describes the behavior of the system. First one is the data-driven modeling. And under this data-driven modeling, whatever the diagram we are going to follow, it is a data flow diagram. And next one is the event-driven modeling. And the diagram it is going to follow is known as state diagram. The data flow diagram represents the flow of data or data processing in the system. And the state diagram represents the states that are occurring in the system or how the system reacts to events. So let's see each modeling one by one. The first one is the data-driven modeling. The data-driven models show the sequence of actions involved in processing input data and generating an associated output. It is used to show end-to-end processing in the system. So let's see what are the notations which is normally used under this diagram. The first one is the data store. A data store is the storage for permanent data, and it is looks like a rectangular shape. Next notation is known as process. A process or task that is performed by the system, and it is looks like a round rectangular shape. And third one is the data flow. A data flow shows the flow of information, and it is represented by a solid arrow line. Let's take an example of data flow diagram of order processing. A data flow model which shows the steps involved in processing an order for goods in an organization is illustrated in the figure above. The data flow models are used to show how data flows through a sequence of processing steps. The model shows how the order for the goods moves from process to process. It also shows the data stores that are involved in this process. The data flow diagrams have the advantage that they are simple and intuitive. Next approach is event-driven modeling. Event-driven modeling shows how a system responds to external and internal events. It is based on the assumptions that a system has a finite number of states and that events may all cause a transition from one state to another. It also supports a language that is a UML, Unified Modeling Language, which used state diagram based on state charts. State diagrams show system states and events that cause transitions from one state to another. They do not show the flow of data within the system, but may include additional information on the computations carried out in each state. The diagram shows, let's take an example of a state diagram of a microwave oven. This simple microwave has a switch to select full or half power, a numeric keyboard to input the cooking time, a start or stop button, and an alphanumeric display. For safety reasons, the oven should not operate when the door is open and on completion of cooking. And on completion of cooking, a buzzer is sounded. The oven has a very simple alphanumeric display that is used to display various alerts and warning messages. So below shows a tabular description of each state, and it also shows how the stimuli that force state transitions are generated. Next model is structural models, or it is also known as object models. Structural models of software display is the organization of a system in terms of components that make up that system and their relationships. A structural model is new to the software process, which falls directly to software development. It is the framework through which components, attributes, and interrelationships within the system are expressed. So there are different models which comes under this. The first one is known as class diagram. Second is the generalization or inheritance model. And third one is known as aggregation or object aggregation. Let's see one by one. First is the class diagram. In software engineering, a class diagram in the unified modeling language is a type of static structure diagram that describes the structures of system classes, their attributes, operations, and relationships among objects. Class diagram helps to construct the code for the software application development. Let's see some notations which are normally used under class diagram. First one is class name. The name of the class appears in the first partition. So a class diagram consists of one rectangular blocks which is divided into three partitions. So first partition, topmost partition, it is known as class name. Next is the class attributes. It explains the attributes of this class. And third one is the class functions or methods, where methods or functions or operations are shown in the third partition. They are also known as services the class provides. Next is the generalization or inheritance model. Object-oriented modeling involves identifying the classes of objects that are important in the domain. These are then organized into a taxonomy. So word taxonomy is now generally known as a classification scheme that shows how an object class is related to other classes through common attributes and services. To display this taxonomy, the classes are organized into an inheritance hierarchy with the most general object classes at the top of the hierarchy. More specialized objects inherit their attributes and services. The figure shows describes the part of a simplified class hierarchy for a model of a library. This hierarchy gives information about the items held in the library. The library holds various items such as books, music, recordings of films, magazines, and newspapers. In the figure, the most general item is at the top of the tree and has a set of attributes and services that are common to all library items. These are inherited by the classes published item and recorded item, which add their own attributes that are then inherited by lower level items. Inheritance is shown upwards rather than downwards. That is, the arrowhead points from the classes that inherit attributes and operation to the superclass. Rather than use the term inheritance, UML refers to the generalization relationship. Next model is a aggregation or object aggregation. An object is an aggregate of a set of other objects. The classes representing these objects may be modeled using an object aggregation model as shown in figure. Aggregation represents or describes or depicts has a relationship. The notations used for aggregation relationship is a line with a diamond at the end, that is to the class denoting the whole. In this example, I have modeled a library item which is a study pack for a university course. This study pack includes lecture notes, exercises, sample solutions, copies of transparencies used in lectures, and videotapes. So this is all about system models. I hope you will enjoy the video. Thank you.